How moral rules distort referendum outcomes and how to avoid that. That's the topic of my talk today, which summarizes the research that I have been doing on this for at least 10 years with Pedro Magalhães from the University of Lisbon. Well, probably you think that this is not a very important topic, but let me assure you that the quorum rules are very common in referenda. At least one half of the countries in Europe do have some kind of quorum rule. Several states in Germany, several states in the United States will also have some type of rules, of quorum rules when applied to referendums. And these are also very common in legislative bodies. For example, most parliaments require a 50% participation for a vote to be binding. So why are these quorum rules so common? Well, I guess the first argument is that we want to be sure that the results are legitimate. We want to be sure that a threshold of a given number of people participated in the decision. Otherwise, we would not consider the results to represent the expression of the collectivity. Also, when we have low turnout, we always have which means high abstention rate. We cannot be sure that the people who vote and the people who abstain have similar opinions, and in that case, if they have different opinions, then the expression, then the votes may not represent the opinion of the majority of the population. And finally, this is an argument that sometimes people forget, but it makes sense to make changing the status quo more difficult. The status quo represents a given equilibrium that the society achieved. And therefore, if we want to change it, we really want to be sure that that most of the people want to change that. So a quorum rule makes the hurdle a little bit higher, and that makes the change a little bit more difficult. So one consequence, obviously, of having quorums is that quorum busting strategies become common. One example, which is interesting, happened 15 years ago in Italy. There was a referendum about in vitro fertilization, and there was a cardinal, Cardinal Ruini, who explicitly asked people not to vote. Even the Pope, a few days before the referendum, in a speech, said this: "What is the principle of wisdom if not to abstain from all that is odious to God? If not to abstain." This is a very explicit appeal for people to abstain. Well, what were the results? The results were that 90% of the people who voted yes for the change in the law, but the abstention was 75%, the quorum was not satisfied, therefore the law did not change, so the church won. Another interesting example happened a few years ago in Illinois, where the Democratic senators running away from the state to be sure that the state police could not force them to go back to the Congress in order to vote. And my favorite example is actually given by Abraham Lincoln, an example from the 19th century. Abraham Lincoln jumped out of the window in order to deny a quorum in the Illinois legislature. Probably you're thinking, why? Why the hell did he use the window? Why didn't he use the door? Well, the reason is simple. The doors were locked because he had done this before, and they wanted to be sure that he would do it again. We are going to consider three types of quorum rules. The easiest one, no quorum. Whoever receives the majority of the votes wins. The second, which is the quorum that we have in Portugal and in Italy and in the majority of the countries, which is the participation quorum, that basically tells us that for a result to be, for a yes victory to be binding, the overall turnout has to be above a particular threshold, typically 50%. So, during this presentation, I'm going to treat not meeting the quorum as the same as a victory of the no. Okay, no means the victory of the status quo, yes, a change in the status quo. And I know that in Portugal this is not the case, because in Portugal the quorum has never been met, but then the parliament votes according to the decision of the majority of the people. But in most countries this is not the case. They take the participation quorum seriously, and if the quorum is not met, the law simply does not change. In some countries they do not even count the votes in such a case. And then finally we have the approval quorum, which also exists in some countries like Denmark, for example, that tells us that the result of a referendum is binding only if the yes vote represents more than a particular share of the overall electorate. Well, now this completely changes the incentives of the conservatives, the people who want to keep the status quo. To see that, let's look at the geometry of these three different quorum rules. So in the first picture, we have the case of no quorum. Okay, in this case, whoever receives the majority of the votes wins. So the green area represents a majority of the yes votes, the red area a majority of the no votes. So the green represents change, and the red region the status quo. Now, in the case of a participation quorum, the status quo region is enlarged, okay, is enlarged by this triangle here. Why is that? Because even if the result is above the 45 degree line, meaning that the majority of the votes are yes, even in such a case, it's possible that the quorum is not met. And if the quorum is not met, the status quo prevails. Now, in the case of the approval quorum, the status quo region is also enlarged, okay, but with a different shape. Why is that? Because the rule that I'm applying here is that the quorum is met if more than 25% of the people of the electorate voted yes. Okay, so we have here a straight, a horizontal line. Now, this completely changes the incentives, because in the case of a participation quorum, if you are a conservative and if you believe that yes will receive the majority of the votes, your best strategy is to abstain, okay? So that you contribute to not meeting the status quo. However, in the case of the approval quorum, a conservative deciding to abstain will have no impact on the quorum. Mm-hmm. So, the simple exercise should tell us that we should expect that in the presence of a participation quorum, some people, some conservatives will abstain rather than voting, and that with the presence of an approval quorum, such an effect would not exist. This could be proved in a more formal model, mathematical rational choice model, but I'm avoiding big formulas, so I will not show them here. All these arguments naturally lead us to these main hypotheses. If there is a participation quorum, we should expect a lower turnout than when such requirement is not present. And actually, we can even be more precise about this prediction, because we saw that the incentive for a conservative to abstain under a participation quorum, it really happened when they expected a majority for change, a yes majority. So we have this prediction from this model's prediction that referendums held under participation quorum should have lower turnout if the yes option is the favorite. Okay, if the status quo is expected to win, then actually there is no extra incentive for conservatives to abstain. In the case of an approval quorum, given that the approval quorum does not change the incentives, we do not expect or we should not expect any implication on any effect on turnout. Of course, when we take this model to the data, we need to control for all the other things that may influence turnout. Otherwise, we could have biased results if we were excluding some relevant variables, like if voting is mandatory or not, if the referendums were held at the same time as other elections or not. We know that in Portugal, the referendums are always a unique election. It's never mixed with other elections, but other countries do not follow this rule. For example, in the United States, several referenda were held during the presidential elections, and so on and so forth. So we controlled for all these several variables that have been marked in the literature as having an important explanatory power in explaining, in predicting turnout in an election. Okay, so to take the model to the data, of course, we need to gather the data. We rely on the Direct Democracy database. We gather data from several sources, naturally, like economic data and social political data, but the data for the referenda were taken from this database. We focused our analysis on the current member states of the European Union. By the time we did this paper in 2008-2009, the United Kingdom was still part of the European Union. And we excluded the analysis all the referenda in which democracy was still not well established. Given the way we presented our model, a yes or no situation, we excluded all the referenda where we had more than two alternative options. Just to give you a sense of the quorum rules in European countries, you can see here that there are several countries that have participation quorum rules. Okay, most of them are about 50%, but for particular cases in Lithuania, you still have a 75% participation quorum. And in the case of the approval quorum, you have several countries also with that quorum. Denmark 40%, Hungary 25%, Ireland 33.3%, and so on and so forth. So after gathering the data, we need to choose the estimation method. We rely on a binary choice model, the minimum logit chi-square estimator. I guess I'm not going to spend time discussing this. This is really technical. People who are interested, please check the paper and I'll be glad to discuss these methods with you. But let me just tell you that using the typical ordinary least squares estimation, the results would be very, very similar. So this choice does not affect the results in a relevant way. So let me show you the results. In this table, we have the results for every variable that we discussed before, but the ones that matter to us are the ones about participation quorum. And what you see, let's look at the second model here. Here we have everything that I want to tell you. So if there is a participation quorum and the no won, okay, In that case, you see no star over there, saying that, meaning that this variable has no discernible effect on turnout. However, when yes wins, meaning that change got the majority of the votes, you see that you have a negative sign, saying that, meaning that turnout decreased. This decrease is very, very relevant from a statistical perspective. That's what these three stars mean. And actually, so on average, this means that the turnout is 11.4 percentage points below what would be if there was no, if there were no participation quorum. So this is a very striking result. And regarding the approval quorum, you see no star over there, meaning that the results are not statistically significant. So we have no reason to reject our initial hypothesis that the approval quorum had no impact in turnout. So our results confirm our theory. Our empirical results confirm our theory. And therefore, it seemed that we were on safe ground saying that a country that wants to impose a quorum in their a quorum rule in their referenda should impose an approval quorum. Because with the participation quorum, you have all these distortionary effects caused by conservatives having an incentive to abstain. However, we received two criticisms that are not easy to deal with. The first one is that we used aggregated data instead of individual data. So we used data for the for a country. So without using without individual data, we are really not sure of what are the motivations of each elector. We don't know why they did abstain and why they did vote. So that's one criticism. The other one is actually more, is even more relevant, which is that maybe the causality works the other way. So we are saying here that because of the existence of the participation quorum, people will participate less. Well, you can argue it's the other way around. Because we already know, or because the politicians already know that people will tend not to participate in referenda, they will impose the quorum, okay, to guarantee that any referendum result is representative of the population's will. Okay, in this case, the causality is reversed, and although we can argue that our results are, that that is not the case, with our results, we were not able to convince everyone. And so we took our research to the next stage, which is to take it to the laboratory. So let's move to the lab. The idea of an experiment, of an economic experiment in the lab, is to grab a few people and ask them to play a game, in this case, a voting game. Okay, in the game, we'll have a few rules that will try to match the theory that we are trying to test. In this case, the impact of different quorums in our voting behavior. So we'll divide the people between the two teams. There will be one team of conservatives and one team of changers. Mm-hmm. So the conservatives wish a no victory, and the changers, of course, want yes to win. Overall, we are going to consider 9. The team overall, in each experiment, we'll have 9 electors. We will run several experiments, so in the end, we'll have a few hundreds of electors, and each of them will play the game several times, so we will end up with a few thousands of observations. Each person will know his voting cost. Okay, so there is a voting cost, and only knows the distribution of the other voters, does not know the specific value that each one will have. You also know, if each person will also know if they are a conservative or a changer, if they are in team 1 or team 2, But they will only know, or they will only have an expectation about the others. They will not be sure. And now to be sure that these people play the game the best way they can, that they have the right incentives to play the game, we actually pay them. And we pay about 25 euros to the winners. Okay? So if you are a conservative and the no wins, we will give you 25 euros. If you are a changer and if the yes wins, we will give you 25 euros, minus the voting costs that we had, that you incurred for voting. We will consider different scenarios, okay? Landslide and toss-up scenarios. So we'll have situations in which there is a huge majority for conservatives or a huge majority for changes, or 5-4-4-5 scenarios. Okay, so I'm not going into the details of the game, which would be a presentation by itself, interesting one, but I don't have enough time for that. So I'm going to jump to the results that we got. Okay, so in the picture in the left, we have the results for the participation quorum. We are comparing the participation quorum with no quorum. The black line gives us the results for the in the case of no quorum. Mm-hmm. These things are the error bars, so they give us the 95% confidence intervals. And what we can see here is that if you are, for example, in a let's look at this. You are a conservative and you are expected to lose in a 4-5 scenario. This is a 4-5 scenario. What we have that if you are a conservative, the probability that you will vote decreases a lot in the presence of a participation quorum. If you are a changer, actually your participation rate slightly increases, but it's not statistically significant. Okay, so we have the result that we had before. Conservatives in the presence of a participation quorum, they tend to abstain a lot. Now, when we go to the approval quorum, we get a different result. Okay, so we also get that the conservatives tend to vote less in the presence of an approval quorum than if there were no quorum. Okay, not as much as with a participation quorum, but the effect is there. Okay, with the supporters, there is some slight tendency to vote a little bit more, but it is not statistically significant. So this creates a problem. And the problem is that our experiment does not confirm our empirical results. There is an incompatibility between our experiment and what the data from the real world tell us. In that case, you have to accept that your experiment is wrong. It doesn't make sense to argue that the reality is wrong. So we need to find where the problem is and to change the experiment accordingly. And we actually believe that we found the problem. Well, we made this a pure strategic game in which people only vote because they want to win the 25 euros. So the best strategy is actually for you to stay at home and not incur in the voting costs and let the other guys of your team to vote. Mm-hmm. And so you win the election and you free ride the other guys who voted for you. In the real world, we can accept that lots of people vote because they like to vote. There is some kind of civic duty to vote. And so we, in another series of experiments, we changed this previous experiment by adding a little twist, which is to give some payment, not very much, like a symbolic payment for people who voted. Okay, so now you have this, you have another incentive to vote, okay, just to receive this small prize, let's call it voting prize, that tries to capture your satisfaction. And in that case, as I'll show in the next slide, in that case, our experiment results will coincide with the results we got from the real world data. This is what we can see in this slide. On the left, we have the results of the second experiment in which we introduced this voting prize, small voting prize. And you can see the effect of the different quorums on conservatives. Okay, and we have here that that the effect of a participation quorum is to decrease turnout, the participation rates by a lot. The green line gives us the results for the approval quorum. You can see that it slightly depresses turnout, but this is not statistically significant. The confidence, the 95 confidence intervals do overlap. And when we look at the effect on changers, we see that the approval quorum has no impact at all compared with the no quorum case, the black line, and that the participation quorum slightly increases participation rates, but not much. It's still not statistically significant. So overall, we see that just by allowing the possibility, just by considering a small voting prize, which mathematically is the same as having a negative voting cost, we reconcile our results between observational data and the experimental data. So we now may have a good model to give some advices. Okay, some advice. And the results are clear. If we are concerned with low turnout, then of course the approval quorum is preferable. Why is that? Because with participation quorum, turnout is even lower. And now, because this was a controlled experiment, we are sure about the direction of causality. Okay? We know that the causality runs from participation quorum to low participation rates. If you are concerned about distortions that low turnout may cause, well, then definitely you should avoid the participation quorum, because that's the one that introduces distortions by promoting abstention among a particular group of voters. And finally, I did not show this because I didn't have time, but you can show that the existence of a participation quorum increases the probability of the wrong result. Okay? So if there is a majority of conservatives, it increases the probability that changers will win. And if there is a majority of changers, it increases the probability that conservatives will win. So participation quorum is a really bad, it's worst possible quorum. And it's the one that we have in Portugal and in several other countries. So we should change that. Before finishing this, let me just tell you that a task force was created in California to evaluate their constitutional law regarding referendum. And they concluded that, because they have several referendums in California, and they concluded that everything was working reasonably well, so there was really no reasons to change the constitutional law, except that they propose that you should add a quorum. And as you can see in this discussion, so this is taken from their document, they suggest that you should consider an approval quorum and not a participation quorum. Okay, In the case of a participation quorum, there is an opportunity to game the system, and therefore they do not suggest adopting a participation quorum in California. And to my amusement, they actually cite my work with Pedro Magalhães. So this type of work is already having some impact in the real world, which is something, of course, that is nice to know. Thank you.